Surely there is not a simple, logical system that underlies the huge variety of illnesses and symptoms. Or is there? In fact, there is such a system at the level of tissue types, for the understanding of which, the knowledge of the three embryonic germ layers is an important prerequisite. Embryonic germ layers are the first differentiating cell layers of precursors of an embryo, from which develop the organ systems and finally the complete organs. These germ layers are therefore the basic tissue types of the human body. Each tissue thus comes from one of the three germ layers: endoderm, mesoderm, or ectoderm. The mesoderm is then divided once more into old mesoderm and new mesoderm. In the first part of pregnancy, the endoderm forms all the tissues for later ingesting food and oxygen, excreting, reproducing, and rudimentary perception of the environment in terms of danger or food. These include the majority of the digestive tract, the lung alveoli, the middle ear, the primal socket that will later form further parts of the eye, the prostate gland, the uterine lining, and various other tissues. The associated control centers of these tissues are located in the oldest part of the brain, the so-called brainstem. Let's take a look at the old mesoderm next. All tissues resulting therefrom have protection and supply functions, including, for example, various protective tissues such as the dermis, pericardium, pleura, and peritoneum, nerve sheaths, and sebaceous, sweat, and mammary glands. These tissues are controlled by the cerebellum. The new mesoderm develops into the tissues of the entire supporting and attachment apparatus, providing stability, flexibility, power, and performance. These include all bones, voluntary muscles, tendons and ligaments, the dentin of the teeth, and the blood and lymphatic system. The cerebral pith, also known as the cerebral medulla or cerebral white matter, i.e., the inner area of the cerebrum, controls these tissues. The tissues that develop from the ectoderm are important for the contact with the outer world and for the interaction and hierarchy formation with other living beings of the same species. These include the epidermis, the nerves, the enamel, various mucous membranes, a large part of the sensory organs, and the regulation of sex hormones. All of these tissues and functions are under the control of the cerebral cortex. Why this lengthy excursion to the embryonic germ layers and the early development of the child in the womb? Because all tissues of one germ layer behave the same within their respective SBS. There are two ways in which individual tissues can basically adapt to a situation perceived as conflictive. Possibility one: the function of a tissue is first increased in the conflict-active phase. In the salivary glands, for example, an increase in function naturally produces more saliva. After resolution of the conflict, the function is then reduced again, so that by the end of the SBS, the normal tissue function is restored. Possibility two. Here, the function of a tissue in the conflict-active phase is first reduced, and then increased again after the conflict has been resolved. At the epidermis, for example, this results in less sensitivity or even numbness due to the reduction in function. As with the first possibility, the normalization of the tissue function ensues. The adaptation behavior of the two possibilities is therefore exactly opposite. All tissue belonging to the endoderm or old mesoderm belong to the first group. All tissues belonging to the new mesoderm or ectoderm belong to the second group. Let's take a look at the skin as an example. It consists of several layers and also appendages such as hair, sweat, and sebaceous glands, each of which originate from a specific embryonic germ layer, so that their behavior is predetermined by the two-phase nature of their SBS. So, one biological conflict and one SBS of the skin per se don't exist. You have to pinpoint the tissue experiencing the symptom. Let's take a look at the outer skin, the so-called epidermis. One of its tasks is the feeling of closeness and contact because of its high sensitivity. If, for example, an infant is separated from its mother in the wild, it could easily turn into food for a predator. So, sensing contact is stored in its biological code as vital for survival. The conflict content of the epidermis is therefore the contact separation, or even if there is unwanted or wrong contact. If a newborn is suddenly separated from his mother in the clinic, it can easily be perceived as a biological conflict with a break in contact with the mother as a conflict content. In the baby, the SBS of the epidermis starts, parallel on the psyche, brain, and organ levels. In the conflict active phase, the epidermis becomes numb, dry, and brittle due to the reduction of function with subsequent cell depletion. After a while, if the conflict resolves, after rest and confidence has been restored, the epidermis will increase in function and increase in cell count, making it hypersensitive, inflamed, reddened, and painful for the predetermined duration of the conflict resolved phase, which will then end with itching. Only the rhythm, the intensity, and the duration of the SBS decide whether the conventional medical diagnosis, without the knowledge of the five biological laws, is hyperesthesia, eczema, dermatitis, neurodermatitis, etc. That the current birth situation is often very conflictive for mothers, fathers, and babies explains the frequent occurrence of strong symptoms in the early days after childbirth. Many women who have gained experience with the five biological laws or have intuitively recognized today's birthing practices as problematic make their pregnancies and births significantly different than was previously the case. Returning to our introductory example, the kidney collection tubules belong to the endoderm, i.e., in the context of an SBS, they react with increased function and cell proliferation, which leads to an increased reabsorption of water. After conflict resolution, there is always a function reduction and cell removal until normalization. The mammary glands belong to the old mesoderm. That is, in the context of an SBS, they react with functional enhancement and cell proliferation. And so after conflict resolution, with hypofunction and cell decay until normalization. Until now, the knowledge of the germ layers and tissue affiliations was missing from the tumor patient in our example to determine SBS phase based on symptoms. Based on simple function enhancement with cell proliferation and function reduction with cell removal, almost all physical changes can be explained and understood. Be it a jaundice due to bilirubin backlog because the ectodermal bile duct is swollen, due to the process that enables cell proliferation in the conflict resolved phase, or hair loss due to reduced function of the ectodermal hair follicles in the conflict active phase, or bone loss due to reduced function of the new mesodermal bone in the conflict active phase, or melanoma due to functional enhancement of the dermis in the conflict active phase, or a purulent pimple due to cell degradation in the sebaceous gland in the conflict resolved phase, or a gut polyp due to cell proliferation of the intestinal mucosa in the conflict active phase, etc., etc. By knowing the tissue affiliation to the embryonic germ layer and their behavior in the context of the biphasic nature of the SBS, Dr. Hammer has shown in the third biological law of nature that every physical symptom can be broken down exactly if the symptoms have been accurately ascertained. And so the triggering situation in the life of the person can be found and examined. If a person has, for example, conjunctivitis, we know or may look up that this belongs to the ectoderm. As a result, we know that the SBS is in the conflict-resolved phase because that is when the previous cell decrease is reversed, which results in swelling and inflammation symptoms. So it is quite certain that she must have resolved a conflict with the content of the conjunctiva shortly before, which can be determined relatively precisely through questioning. The content of the conflict is about losing sight of something important. For example, because at the crucial moment you closed your eyes, fell asleep, or looked away. As always, when asking for conflict content, one has to find different formulations that are understandable for each person. Now you may be wondering, okay, so now what? On the one hand, that sounds quite plausible, but do I now believe in the five biological laws of nature? Or rather in established medicine with its thousands of doctors, billions of research funds, professors, textbooks, and studies? In the next part, we will see how you have the opportunity to check the laws themselves and what else is needed. Then this question of belief vanishes because then you can test yourself, experience, and therefore know.